Teachers Association. I'm the program specialist, and I help out in the Lincoln and surrounding communities. But our chapter actually covers the state of Nebraska, so we have two other offices. One is in Omaha, and then the other one is in Columbia. Today, like Carly mentioned, I'm going to give you basic information about Alzheimer's disease, dive into it, what's really going on with the brain, what is memory loss, how to tell the difference between what's just typical aging and what's more serious. And then after that, I will be giving you guys a quiz and seeing how much information you obtain. And you're gonna have to come up here and tell me which ones you got right and wrong. I'm just kidding. I saw the horror on your guys' faces and it had to be a joke for Friday. There will be no quiz. But certainly if there are any questions that you have during the presentation, ask me. I'm happy to answer them as we're going through the material. The first slide is a video, and throughout this presentation it's nice because it's broken up. You'll hear me talk, but then also you get to hear other people talk. And the nice thing is you'll hear people with the disease, you'll hear from caregivers, and then you'll also hear from leading medical professionals in this field as well. And the first one is Dr. Ron Peterson, and he talks about how Alzheimer's is impacting our community, but not only our community, but really the world.
In general, we talk about in individuals age 65 and older that people have perhaps an 8 to 10% risk of developing Alzheimer's disease over their lifetime. But it's clearly age-related. So if your family tends to live into their 80s and maybe 90s, your risk is going to go up rather dramatically. On the other hand, if people in your family tend to die in their 70s, the risk is lower. But it's clearly an age-related phenomenon, and with baby boomers, now those individuals born between the years of 1946 and 1964, moving into their 60s, this is going to exaggerate the number of people eligible, so to speak, for Alzheimer's disease rather dramatically. Some people have indicated that if we do not do something for Alzheimer's disease, meaning delay the onset, slow the progression. Ideally, we'd like to cure the disease, but even if we have these modulating effects on Alzheimer's disease, it, as a single entity, will bankrupt the healthcare system as we know it, because there are so many people in that age who will need services, will need extra care, that this will bankrupt the system.
You know, he makes a really good point. He talks about, because of the baby boomers getting into the age of 65 and older, it's going to start affecting our healthcare, which it has clearly already. But he talks about it bankrupting the system. If you think about what that means, is a person who lives with Alzheimer's disease generally is about 8 years with the disease. It can go up to 20. And as they need more care, you know, the cost of care is going to go up and up. And especially in the later stages of Alzheimer's disease, you're looking at people who need full-time care. And that's where he talks about it's going to bankrupt America, because with a certain amount of dollars that we have in Medicaid and Medicare, it can't financially sustain this if we don't prevent, don't prevent this disease or slow it down. You might be asking yourself, what are typical age-related changes? And on the screen, it kind of gives you an idea of what some of those might be. And we have to think about it. As our body age, our minds age with us. And so if it was once easier for us to jump, lift, move, as we age, it becomes a little bit more challenging to do those things. The same way with our brain. We lose part of the agility that we might have had in our 20s or 30s. And so there are some things that we do typically see with age-related changes. And as you can see, it's making a bad decision every once in a while. sometimes forgetting which word to use or losing things from time to time. We all get busy, right? But you might be thinking, what is the difference between Alzheimer's and what is the difference between just typical age-related changes? And that's truly what this presentation is about, is what are the warning signs that we need to look for? And in our next video, Joyce, who has Alzheimer's disease, talks about the changes that she saw in herself.
I noticed there was a time when I was dialing the phone and the buttons were, I couldn't dial a phone. And so I went to the neurologist and they did some tests and they said it didn't seem that anything yet was different. But then a couple of months later, I noticed that not only could I not dial a phone, but I was having difficulties writing. I was having difficulties spelling simple words like of and the. I was falling a lot. I began to have accidents, like minor accidents, driving accidents. And at that time, my husband said, you know, we're going to the doctor.
And as you can see on the screen in front of you, here are the 10 warning signs. And to kind of lightly go through what that looks like, the first one you see is memory changes that disrupt daily life. And the key part is disrupts daily life. It is challenging for them to continue on with whether it's work or hobbies or just our daily activities. It becomes more and more of a challenge for them to complete those. Challenging in planning or solving problems. Here, I look at my grandmother, who she had all the family recipes stored in her head. She knew how to make them front and backwards. It was adding a little bit of this and a little bit of that. There was actually no exact measurement. But when the changes came to where she was having trouble completing those types of recipes, she pulled out the recipe card, and yet she was still having trouble with completing those. So as you can see, that's a big warning sign for my grandmother, is she was struggling to complete these recipes that she had done for several years, but now is starting to have issues trying to complete those. Difficulty completing a familiar task. And this I look at somebody who might be an avid card player. They could be a bridge player. And now they are starting to, you know, they played bridge for many years, but now they're starting to make mistakes that normal bridge players should know better. And it could get to the point where you see number 9 when they start to withdraw because they are having issues and they don't want other people to see that I'm having these issues. So again, it's something that they were able to do and now are having problems completing whatever that task may be. Confusion with place or time. You know, I don't know if you guys take President's Day off. Yeah? Okay. We do too. So I'll be celebrating it with you. But something that might be the challenge is when we get back to work on Tuesday, we all think, oh, it's Monday, but the reality is, no, it's really Tuesday. We just have that extra day off. That's normal. But for somebody who has Alzheimer's disease or another form of dementia, it's much more than that. They start to lose the sense of time altogether, whether it's the seasons, and then it moves on to what year it is, and it can continue on through their different life stages as well. But it's also maybe walking into Walmart and they completely forgot, where am I at? You know, they couldn't remember maybe driving to Walmart, they couldn't remember what visual images and spatial relationships. This is a huge one. This really revolves around driving. A lot of times we hear from our caregivers. I had one gentleman say his wife and him were driving on the interstate and she was going 100 miles an hour. She didn't understand it wasn't appropriate to drive 100 miles an hour in a 75 mile an hour zone. As you can imagine, he was frantic trying to get her to slow down and stop the car. He did say that was the last time she drove, so she is not driving. But that just shows you an example. Another example I've heard from family caregivers is my loved one doesn't know when to, what color at a stoplight to stop. So they'll stop at yellow, they'll stop at green, because they can't remember which one exactly do I need to be stopping at. A lot of times we'll hear that they have an issue with judging distance and the time it takes. So let's say if they're turning left and there's oncoming traffic, they lose that judgment of, can I turn in front of this car safely? And so a lot of times we see that happen is they're not able to judge that distance between their car and the other car as well. New problems with words and speaking. So in typical age-related changes, we might be in the middle of a conversation and talking about an actor and an actress, and we couldn't remember what the name of that actor or actress was. We could see their face, but it was on the tip of our tongue and we couldn't remember it. And then at 2 o'clock in the morning, it dawns on us, that was the name of the actor or actress. Well, for somebody who has Alzheimer's disease or dementia, if they are trying to remember something, the likelihood of them remembering it later on is slim to none. Even if you told them maybe what it is that they're trying to say, that if this was a pen, they're still going to be like, no, that's not it. But we're able to maybe use a different word, writing utensil or something of that nature, but they have trouble with coming up with new words to describe something as well. Misplacing things or losing the ability to retrace steps. Unfortunately, our caregivers get the brunt of this. Because of the disease and the progression of the disease, they lose the ability to retrace their steps. And with that, it could be setting down their wallet. You know, maybe they've always put their wallet on their desk at home, and now it's not there. So they say, somebody had to obtain it, because I know I always put it there, and it's not there. And they honestly believe that. And the best thing that a caregiver can do, even if they're saying that you took it, you stole it, you moved it, is saying, I'm sorry, but let's look for it together. Even though you might not have nothing to do with it, I am still trying to find that one person who's won an argument with the person who has Alzheimer's disease or a form of dementia. You're just going to upset them, and it's unfortunately going to turn into an escalated fight instead of trying to reason. So that's where the decreased or poor judgment comes into play. They lose that capability of using that judgment. A lot of times we see this in paying bills, whether it's telemarketers calling them, asking for money. A lot of times we see that they give out money because they lose that ability to understand it's going to be coming out of my bank account. A lot of tellers might see that they're pulling out large sums of money, you know, $4,000 or $5,000, when normally they would have never have done that in the past. So we actually get quite a few banks calling us saying we're really concerned about our client. Withdraw from work or social activities. I kind of already mentioned that. They have trouble with participating in a conversation. They might lose their train of thought and not know where to pick up from or start over again. And then lastly, changes in mood and personality. It's a big one. This disease revolves around mood and personality. Actually, 80% of it is mood and personality changes. Now that we've kind of covered a little bit, you might be asking yourself, so what is dementia? What is the difference between dementia and Alzheimer's disease? Dementia is the umbrella term. And underneath that umbrella, there's many different diseases. So dementia is actually, it's not a disease itself. It actually refers to the condition or symptoms that cause a cognitive decline. So dementia, there has to be causing dementia. There has to be a reason why dementia is happening. Dementia simply means that you're having trouble with a cognitive decline. But what the reasoning for that is, that's what we have to figure out. That's what physicians have to figure out. There's many different diseases or medical conditions that can cause a form of dementia, but we have to investigate what exactly is causing this to happen. So I'm gonna read verbatim what the term of dementia is. So it's symptoms that occur when the brain is affected by a specific disease or a medical condition that causes a cognitive decline. It's significant enough that impacts your daily life. And that's the key, is impacts daily life for dementia. So it's actual symptoms is what it's referring to. But what's causing those symptoms, that's what falls under the umbrella. So as you see Alzheimer's disease, but there's also vascular dementia, Lewy body disease, which is, vascular is number two, but we're actually seeing more and more Lewy body. There's reversible dementias that are out there as well. And these diseases that are all dementia, their makeup, how they progress, the symptoms, and the pathology are all very different. And that's why it's crucial to get an assessment done, to make sure you know exactly what's causing this and why it's happening. You have progressive dementia, like Alzheimer's disease, which gradually gets worse over time. But like I said, there are reversible dementias that if you get on the proper medication, it can clear it up altogether. So what causes dementia and whether or not it can be reversible depends on what form of dementia you might have. Does that make sense? Do I need to clarify?
What is Lewy body disease?
Good question. Lewy body disease and Parkinson's dementia are very similar to one another. You'll start to see the shuffling of the feet, the rigidness. The big distinction between Lewy body and Parkinson's is Lewy body dementia, they usually have hallucinations. It's not scary hallucinations that they have. But typically we've seen people who see children, or they might see a purple man in the room. They can sit there and have a conversation with their hallucinations. And the best way to typically handle that as a caregiver is not to sit there and fight, no, you're not seeing these things, is to embrace it, to really embrace it and say, oh, how are they doing today? And going on with the conversation like that. The most challenging form of dementia, I think, in my personal opinion, to get diagnosed is the front temporal dementia, which is caused by your temporal lobe, which is this front lobe. It deals more with your filter than it deals with memory. So they could be saying inappropriate things. They could be, you know, that poor judgment, that poor reasoning, that is what you typically see with that form of dementia, and it's one of the hardest because you can give them several tests, but a lot of times their memory is still sharp as a tack. But it's that judgment, that reasoning. You know, somebody who might be overbearing, it gets dicey because you're like, well, they've always been overbearing, or they're just getting old, so they're just kind of crotchety. Well, not necessarily is that the case. You know, we see a lot of gentlemen who will kind of maybe grab women inappropriately, same way with women, but we typically see more with our males. So it really is a tricky one to get diagnosed. It's not necessarily something that you can point out in behavior-wise, or that one, you really have to look at the brain and see what's going on. But vascular dementia, like I had mentioned, is number two right now. And that one deals cardiovascular. So typically we see, you know, a stroke can cause vascular dementia, but also you can see any heart-related issues play a factor in this. And truly the reason why you see that is if you think about your brain, it's being nourished by your heart. It's getting its nourishment by the blood. Well, if your heart is not working at its fullest capability, then your brain can't do the same. And so it's going to have some kind of implication on the brain, large or small, but it's still going to have an impact on that brain as well. Do you guys have any questions on the other forms of dementia? Okay. We typically see with dementia, people always just assume it's the memory. But it actually affects many other areas as well. As I had talked about language, you know, it could be with speaking, it could be with writing. You heard from, what's her name? Joyce. And she talked about how spelling the word of or the was challenging for her. That's not your memory coming into effect. That's the actual language that they're having issue. Thoughts, navigation, like I said, losing their ability to maybe, they went to a hardware store like Ace Hardware. We had a gentleman who always went there every week, twice a week, who knows. And his loved one said that now he's having trouble finding the hardware store. Several years. So navigation plays into effect. Behavior, personality, mood, but also planning and organizing, the executive functionings do take effect with dementia as well. Reversible types of dementia, irreversible, I should say. As I had mentioned, Alzheimer's is the most common form of dementia, and it makes up 70% of the people, it's actually 70-80% have a form of Alzheimer's disease. And it's a little bit interesting, Alzheimer's disease, because the forms of dementia, like I said, they're all a little bit differently, but we see more Alzheimer's. And I think that's where people get Alzheimer's and dementia in a mix and think that they mean the same thing. So when they say, well, my loved one has dementia, I always ask, well, what form of dementia do they have? You know, some people went on to get a thorough diagnosis, and others, unfortunately, a physician said, well, you have dementia, here's some medications, we'll see if it works, and come back to it, which I'll tell you that's my worst nightmare, but we'll go more into detail with that later. Mild cognitive impairment, or MCI, comes before the diagnosis of a form of dementia. And what this is, I like to describe it as lightning forgetful. Typically, we see people who have the mild cognitive impairment. They're pretty likely forgetful, but they're still able to continue on in their daily living. You know, they might have different cues to help them remind them to do different things, but they're still able to be active in the in their daily activities. And with mild cognitive impairment, problems are memory, language, and other mental functions, and it's severe enough to be noticed in other people and even show up on tests, but the big factor is it does not disrupt their daily life, unlike a form of dementia would. One thing you need to know is if you do have MCI, you will have a higher chance of it developing into Alzheimer's disease. It doesn't mean you will for sure get Alzheimer's disease, but because that damage has been done to the brain, it makes it a little bit easier. Your brain is a little bit more susceptible to Alzheimer's disease because of that. What is Alzheimer's disease? So we are going to hammer out, what is Alzheimer's disease and what does it mean? So I mentioned it's the most common form of dementia. There are over 5 million people in the United States that have a form of Alzheimer's disease. 5 million. It goes up to 44 million throughout the world. So it's clearly not just in the United States. It's a world epidemic, and this is something that the Alzheimer's Association is very much invested in other countries who are looking at different research for Alzheimer's and other forms of dementia. But it is a progressive disease. So 1 out of 9 over the age of 65 will develop the disease, and it goes up to 1 out of 3 over the age of 85. 1 out of 9 over the age of 65 to 1 out of 3 over the age of 85. It really significantly increases as you age. Alzheimer's disease is a disease of the brain that causes problems in memory, thinking, and behavior. It is not a normal part of aging. And unfortunately, our research is behind the curve because of that. We actually knew Alzheimer's disease existed in the early 1900s, but we did nothing because we thought it was a normal part of aging. And until recently, until the 1980s, really, we realized this was not normal for everyone does not get Alzheimer's disease. This is not a normal part of aging, and that's when we really started looking into, let's figuring out what's going on and what can we do about it. Alzheimer's disease is progressive, and it is a fatal brain disease. It destroys the brain cells, causing memory loss, problems in thinking, along with severe behavior enough that it affects their daily life. There's no cure, slowdown, or prevention for this disease, which is why we are striving to hopefully get some kind of slowdown or progression. 2025 is the Alzheimer's Association's goal, is to, can we figure out a way to prevent this disease from happening, or at least slow it down? Our next clip is about Steve, and he talks about the most common form of dementia, Alzheimer's disease, and his experience.
The types of things I noticed had to do with organizational abilities, mental abilities, and I was getting confused. I was finding it hard to plan, and there were two pivotal sort of moments that really brought this home to me. And the first one happened when I went into work one morning and sat down at my desk to plan out my day and couldn't figure out what to do. And literally sat there for an hour frozen and could not figure out what piece of paper to pick up first.
But it gives you an idea. idea of Alzheimer's is not black and white. There's a lot of gray to it. How does it affect the brain? In our brain, we have over 100 billion nerve cells. And these neurons, nerve cells, which are neurons, they are crucial in creating forms of communication with each other. Whether it's storing a new information, something that we just learned, whether it's our thoughts, our feelings of what's going on in the situation. But neurons all have special jobs, and their job is to communicate with one another. And if we think about our brain as a tiny factory that goes on, it receives the supplies, generates the energy, stores the information, and then communicates with other cells. So once, if there's a breakdown in that process, it's going to affect other areas of that factory, just like it would in your brain. If there is a disconnect, something's not working, it's going to have an issue with the other parts of the factory or brain as well. What we know that occurs in the brain is it loses, these neurons loses the ability to do their jobs. They lose the ability to communicate with one another, and they start dying off. And because of that, your brain has a harder time trying to do its job because now it's starting to lose those neurons that are key in communicating with one another. And we know Alzheimer's disease destroys these neurons, which we'll look at the brain a little bit, not the next slide, but the next one after it. But what we know with Alzheimer's disease is it goes throughout the brain in a progression. And it first damages the language and the memory, but then it starts moving to other areas of the brain. You have the judgment and reasoning. You have the vision, which is your depth perception. And then lastly, it affects the brainstem, which controls your breathing and a lot of other involuntary type functions. And so at the later stages of Alzheimer's disease, you'll typically see somebody who has trouble with swallowing because they can't remember how to swallow. Typically, you'll see them not want to eat or drink at that point because they struggle with that point as well. And so as you can see in this next slide, what severe Alzheimer's looks like and what a healthy brain looks like. And you can see those neurons. I don't know if this is. You can see how those neurons are dying off and how parts of the brain are missing or gone, so to speak. And the biggest one is the hippocampus part that you really see this place into effect. So the brain really is shrinking. And a lot of times we see with caregivers is it's not physical. You can't physically see that something's wrong with them. And so it's hard for us to wrap our minds around that their brain is not fully working to its full capacity because it's hard to see. You can't see that. And I honestly believe, again, that's a reason why Alzheimer's has a huge stigma attached to it, with a lot of other mental health diseases as well. But if we can't see what's wrong, it's hard for us to fully understand that truly something is not going on correctly. So Kitty talks about her husband's experience with Alzheimer's disease and the problems that they had when he was thinking something's not going right.
Bill had been a graduate student for an advanced degree, and he found himself having difficulty defending his thesis, the last thing that he needed to do. And he started making mistakes at work.
we both somehow knew before he was diagnosed that something was very wrong. At first, we hoped it was something that they could either operate or cut out or burn out or something. Or maybe he was depressed. Maybe he just needed a nice weekend and it would be fine. And then we realized maybe something's really very wrong. And it was. We went through several doctors, several unsuccessful attempts at getting some sort of diagnosis. Each time they would test Bill, he would ace their tests. If they wanted him to count backwards by three, he could count backwards by 3.25. His problems were very, very subtle. And when we finally realized he was laid off from work, and I'm sure that was part of the reason why he was laid off from work. But during the election, when we elected a brand new president, although Bill wasn't working, he wanted to be active. So he volunteered to work at the polls. And he was an officer of the election. And before he left, we were very, very excited about it. It was a long day. It was 5 o'clock in the morning. And we knew, no matter what happened, it was going to be a historical event. So we were very, very excited. We would either have a female vice president or an African-American president. One of the two, and it was going to be huge. So we were excited about it. He went off, worked at the polls, came home and told me, and we were very animated, talked about the people all the way around the block waiting to vote, and we were so excited. We stayed up and watched the acceptance speeches, and we found out who won. And we thought that was just amazing, and it was history. So the next morning, he got up, and Bill said, "I got to get the paper." I said, "Why?" And he said, "I got to see who won." And we both realized, uh-oh, he lost the whole day before because it was such a long day. And that was when I realized how serious it really was.
All right, obviously you can tell that was a little bit of another video, but it still shows a great point that, you know, Alzheimer's is not black and white. Like I had mentioned, there's a lot of gray area. And just because your loved one might show these symptoms but not these symptoms, it makes it challenging. And when you go through the process of getting an assessment and you see how well they do in these areas, but something yet is still wrong, it's a tough one to get diagnosed, especially when you're looking at somebody who's younger. That's not their first typical go-to. When you see that younger Alzheimer's disease as well. Ooh. All right. So what is the greatest risk factor for Alzheimer's disease? See who's been listening.
Age.
Age is correct. Good job, Lynn. A beautiful Friday. But age is your primary risk factor. So as we age, we do have a higher risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. Women have a higher chance than men of developing this disease, largely because we tend to live longer than men. However, we are starting to close that gap in between. Another factor that we need to be aware of is your family history. If somebody in your family has a form of dementia, including Alzheimer's disease, it does give you that higher risk for developing the disease. It doesn't mean you will automatically get it, but it just does give you a little bit higher chance. With Down syndrome, there is a correlated, they are correlated. We see people who have Down syndrome living longer, which typically for them, their life expectancy is shorter to begin with, generally speaking. And so we'll see them get Alzheimer's earlier because of the progression of the disease, but Down syndrome, because they have that extra chromosome, they are more likely able to get Alzheimer's disease because that is the chromosome for Alzheimer's disease as well. So if they have family history of it, it could give them that higher chance of developing the disease as well. Genetics, like I had mentioned, plays a role in this. It's not the only role it plays, as we know, since age is our largest risk factor. But there are two types of genes. You have the younger onset, which is younger or under the age of 65, or you have the later onset, which is over the age of 65. So the younger onset, for those of you who have seen Still Alice, all right, it looks like you guys need to have a day-long video of Still Alice. I saw a couple hands. But Still Alice had the younger onset. Do you remember? I think she turned 50 in that movie.
Was she that old? Amazing.
Yeah.
I think she was 50.
Yeah.
She was
Yeah. And so we typically see with younger onset Alzheimer's, the disease moves quite quickly. Usually it's 2 to 3 years that they have the disease compared to the later onset, which is average about 8 and can go up to 20, roughly, 20 years with the disease. And so that younger onset Alzheimer's affects them much different. Usually we see behaviors are a large factor, more aggressive behaviors, I should say. But in the movie, if you guys remember, that she had 3 children. With the younger onset, they can pass that gene on to their children. And if their children have that genetic gene, then they will develop Alzheimer's sometime in their life. They can't say you're going to have the younger onset or the later. It's just they will develop it sometime in their life. Now, in the movie, which I'm not going to give it away, 2 of her 3 children got tested. And I'm not going to tell you what happened, so you'll have to watch the movie, keeping you guys in suspense here. But the younger onset trait is very rare. You will see it very prominent in your family. Let's say if your mom had the trait, her siblings, her parents, it would go on and on. So you would see it very, very much apparent in those. And it makes up less than 10% of all cases. So it really is quite rare to have that genetic gene. Now the second gene or gene category is that later onset. Which is 65 or above, which is the most common that we typically see. If you go and get tested and you have that gene, it just says you have a higher chance of developing the disease than a person who doesn't have that gene. But it's not a determining factor. And since we already knew family history plays a role, if my loved one has had it, not a lot of people go and get tested because it's kind of a gambling game. It doesn't really tell you verbatim yes or no you're going to get this disease. We already know it's going to be a little bit at a higher risk factor. Cardiovascular brain health plays a big role. Just as I mentioned earlier, with the brain, you know, your brain is being pumped or nourished by the blood and your heart. So if you have heart disease, heart attack, stroke, diabetes, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, all of those things do play an effect on developing Alzheimer's disease because that damage to your heart, it's not fully working. But they've shown if you diet, exercise, keep those under control, whether it's through medication as well, then it does lower your risk factor for developing the disease. Make sure to take care of your body. When you are selecting a doctor, when a family member comes into my office and says, I want to go get my loved one, have an assessment done, where do I go? Well, we recommend starting off with your primary care. They can do some tests in their office to kind of get a baseline. But what we really would like to see is them refer them on to a neurologist, a geriatrician. Fortunately, Lincoln does not have a geriatrician, so you will have to go to Omaha in order to get that, a neuropsych, someone who is more educated. But just because you have a neurologist does not mean that they are educated in this area. So you really want to find somebody who is knowledgeable in this area. And when you're looking at smaller towns, when you're getting out into the Scotts Bluff area, you're lucky if you have a neurologist out there, or maybe two neurologists out there. They might not be the best choice to go on and get an assessment. And I will talk about what an assessment looks like a little bit later. Preparing for a doctor's visit, I tell everyone, no matter what your ages are, if you are taking medications, whether it's prescribed or over the counter, make sure you take them to your doctor's office. Especially when you're going to several different specialists who don't necessarily communicate with one another. And unfortunately, we see it too often to where you're prescribed medications that shouldn't be mixed together. So please, please, please make sure that you always have all the prescriptions. But that also includes, if you take vitamins every day, what types of vitamins are you taking? Supplements. If you take an aspirin every day, your physician needs to know that too. Even though it's over the counter, if it's something that you're taking on a regular basis, it could affect the different medications that they're prescribing to you. For an assessment, we like to see a very thorough assessment because we gotta know what is going on in the brain, what is going on in your body. We have to look at the whole entire picture. First, they start off with the medical history. They're looking at what is your medical history. Do you have high blood pressure, stroke, diabetes? Then they go on to your family medical history to see if do they have Alzheimer's that runs in your family. Also, the mental status evaluation. A lot of times a physician, a primary care, can do this in their office. But it's a tool. It's only a tool that they use. This gives you an idea, roughly, what your mental status is at. But as she said, they do math problems, they do word problems, they do memory problems. And if I was never very good at math, my score in the math department is going to be incredibly low. Doesn't mean I have a form of Alzheimer's or a form of dementia. It just means I was never good at math to begin with. So you have to take that with a grain of salt. It is a starting point. Here's where you were at. 6 months later, you should come back, take the same test to see, are you at the same level? Are you better? Or are you getting worse each time we're taking it? Physical. We're looking at physically, is there something physically going on in your body that might be causing this cognitive decline? Like a urinary tract infection can have major implications, especially on the elderly, to where, you know, somebody who might be perfectly fine one day and the next day they're having trouble feeding themselves. A major impact. It could be, and then they go on to a psychiatric evaluation. Is it dementia that's causing these issues? Because dementia, or depression can mimic the symptoms of a form of dementia. And so knowing if it's depression, we get you on the proper medication, and then all those symptoms are reversed, then we solve the problem. In essence, we really want to make sure that it's a very thorough diagnosis so we can understand what's going on in the body and how can we properly get it treated. When the diagnosis is Alzheimer's disease, the emotions run high. As you can imagine, for the person with the disease, for caregivers, their loved ones. There's many different emotions that go on with this disease. Some people are in denial about the disease, and some people, unfortunately, they're in denial about the disease until their loved one passes. Other people find relief because now at least I know what is going on. I'm not crazy, but I know what's going on and how to go forward, how to move forward, and to plan out what my journey is going to look like. On the slide here, we have the different stages of Alzheimer's disease. I'm just going to lightly go over them. We have the early stages, which typically you do see the memory loss in there, but the driving, money management is a big problem. Actually, a lot of our caregivers said that was one of the first indicators that their loved one had an issue, is when they were balancing out a checkbook and they couldn't remember how to balance it out, or maybe how to add things, subtract things. Middle stage is where we generally see difficulty with language become more of a problem. If it happens in the earlier stages, as the disease progresses, it will get worse. And that's right along with language. You know, I had one caregiver told me his mom was a English major. Her language was impeccable, but it was her memory that she was having problems with. Or a lot of times we see people who were very well kept now might not be, you know, putting on the clothing that they once wore, doing their hair or makeup like they used to do, dressing to the nines. And usually in the middle stages, that's where we see they might need some more help with that. And then the later stages, as the disease progresses, it starts off with that short-term memory, but then continues on, and it goes into their long-term memory. So usually what we see at the later stages, they might talk about their mom or dad because those are their first memories. Those are one of the last memories to go, is those earlier memories, or somebody who might had somebody pass away.